It's a wonderful thing to be back. I appreciate Dr. Phil and Barbara letting me preside today and share the word, particularly on Holy Communion Sunday. So let me share just a couple of quick announcements with you that are in the bulletin. Tomorrow night, the Methodist men will be at 6 o'clock here in our Wesley Center. And the speaker is from Emergency 911. His name is Darren Rambo. And we're looking forward to him sharing with us some vital information about how we can be prepared for things that may happen in our lives. And then Wednesday night, the first wonderful Wednesday, always a good time for a meal and then also for a program. But what I'm really excited about as well, the Morrisseys, Michael and Sherry Morrissey, our missionaries to Thailand, will be here to talk with us. And at 7 o'clock particularly, a talkback session. And they are deal with things like human trafficking in the worst sense of the word, but also have some wonderful stories about how God is ministering in that awful place in that part of the world. We're certainly glad you're here. Ushers, you'll bring the attendance pads now. Let's turn and greet one another and begin the service with a prelude.
Please stand as we read our call to worship responsively. Lord, we gather this year to promise that we will follow the Star of Bethlehem. We have gone the wrong way, followed the wrong stars. We went south, following greed and lust, Star of Wonder. We went east, following stars of militarism, nationalism, and war, Star of Light. We even went north, following our own visions, our own way. Star with royal beauty bright. Lord, this year we will follow the Star of Bethlehem, the Star of hope, the Star of peace, the Star of joy, the Star of love, the Star that is you. Let us celebrate the Star as we turn in hymn 254.
Remind you that you are among those very few that can have perfect attendance in church all year long. Somewhere, here or wherever else you go. I also remind you that we can look at the past of 2015 with its sorrows and its joys and say, okay, now we're in 2016. The things that we could shed, we do. Things that we carry over with us are still with us. The God who was a God of 2015 He's the God of 2016, isn't he? And so we can approach him in prayer. I invite you to join me now. Almighty God, we thank you that you are the God of the ages. We thank you that you are the God that sees us in our best moments this past year when we were just doing what you wanted. And really, a joyful life. And then you saw us when we were at our worst. And you've loved us all the same. We thank you for journeying with us. We pray that you would show us how to be better and to live more like you. For the joys we had, but for some of us, Lord, we've lost loved ones this past year. And you were there by us at the graveside, reminding us of a home in heaven. For some of us, Lord, there were physical issues that were more than we thought we could bear. And we felt you maybe through the eyes and arms and hands of other people, but you were there for us. Some of us, Lord, our relationships just fell apart this past year. We realize that they can be healed when we go beyond our own selfishness and find a way to reach out in love. For some of us, Lord, it's been financial. Others of us, it's been a move. Others of us, it's been a graduation. For all of us, Lord, there have been issues. And so we're glad that we can start this year with a covenant with you, that you'll be our God and we'll be your children. I pray for each one here, for whatever their need may be, that as we enter Holy Communion in a few moments, that we be drawn so close to you, that we'll know that we have your strength and your love to see us through and make us a witness for Christ in this world. Thank you, Jesus, for coming, for dying, for being resurrected. In your holy name, we join together our prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and glory forever. Amen. I invite you to stand now and sing with me a song that will incorporate the words of the sermon today. 163 is Ask Ye What Great Thing I Know, based on 1 Corinthians chapter 2. So see if you can make the connection between the words of the song and then the scripture I'll use later on. Shall we stand as we sing? 163. I wonder, do people make New Year's resolutions anymore? Have you made any resolutions so far this year? I don't make them. In fact, I made one not to make any more New Year's resolutions. They don't seem to work. But they are kind of fun to try to better myself or better yourself. Some of my favorites, though, come from the writing of Irma Bombeck. Some of you remember Irma. She was a spiritual writer in a way, but really a humorist who really related her daily life as a mother and a housewife and as a person in the world to what made her tick, which was a sense of humor. She said there are six favorite New Year's resolutions that she's made. Number one, I'm going to clean up this dump just as soon as the kids grow up. I understand that one. I will go to no doctor whose office plants have died. Think about that. I'm going to follow my husband's suggestion to put a little excitement into our lives by living within our budget. I like this one. I'm going to apply for a hardship scholarship to Weight Watchers. Yeah, I understand. I love this one. I'll never loan my car to anyone I have given birth to. Yeah, you know what that's like. And finally, this brings it all together. I'm going to remember that my children need love the most when they deserve it the least. My children and I need love the most when I deserve it the least. That's the whole message of today, isn't it? But it's a beautiful way. Thank you, Irma, for saying that. I suppose every year they do surveys on the types of resolutions that are most popular. Every year it comes down to encapsulation of three. Number one, and some of us have said, I'm going to lose weight this year. Or I'm going to exercise more this year, or I'm going to eat healthier this year. You put those three together and almost invariably some of us are saying that. And I ask myself the question, if they don't work, it don't seem to by February or March or whenever, I don't seem to achieve what I'm going for. Why do I make them all the time? Why do people still make them? I think there are several reasons. Let me share those with you. Number one, I think we all understand that we need to change. We're not pleased with where we are. We want things to be better. I don't like where I am. My lifestyle is not one healthier, or nicer, smarter, kinder, whatever it is that I want it to be. And so I want to change. And I think that's good, because it's good to know that we can change. That's the whole idea of resolutions. Second reason that people sometimes make resolutions is because they like a new start. It's time to quit doing what I'm doing and start some new good habits. Things I really know will bring good success, make success in my life. But always it happens to me, the same advice I hear as I read a story of the Western pioneers who journeyed from the east, from the Mississippi River out west. They followed the Chisholm Trail and the Oregon Trail, and they followed them in the same roads that they followed people before them. And the advice as they left Missouri was this: pick your rut carefully, because you're going to be in it a long time. What they meant by that was, in those Conestoga wagons, you didn't move them across the road. They fell into the ruts of the people that had gone before, and it's awfully hard to get out of them. Isn't that the way it is? It's awfully hard. We want to start all over again. I'd like to have a new beginning. We say that. It's time for a new beginning. But I think another reason that we make resolutions is just because that's our nature. We have the idea, we Westerners particularly, we Americans particularly, have the idea to get ahead in this life, you got to set some goals and some aims and some resolutions and go for them. And that's right. But the problem is we always seem to fall and fail. I think we've learned the lesson. We can't do them alone. We need some help. And so this is what brings me to the sermon today. If you've made New Year's resolutions, I've suggested to you that we probably better would make a new covenant with God. Because you see, when I make a resolution to myself, I don't tell anybody about it. I never have to be accountable if I break it. Have you noticed that? But it's always good when you can find a friend, a partner, a spouse, or someone say, I'm going to do this. They hold you accountable. So how do we make a good resolution today? Before we come to communion, what can we say? I'd like to use, and I think you can see the scripture found in the hymn that we just sang, Ask You What Great Thing I Know. It's in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. If you want to follow along with that in your Bible or the Pew Bible or on your iPad, you could take a moment. Let me tell you the background. Just like the children that sometimes cost us the most grief may tend to be the ones we love the most, the same thing is true of Paul. For the church at Corinth was one he started. He loved those people. They lived in the middle of a terrible world. But they also had some issues. He was hearing when he was away from them that they were arguing about, well, you know, I followed Paul, or I've been a member of the church longer than you have, or I was baptized by Peter, or Jesus himself, I heard him preaching. They were bragging about who they were, and it began to separate them. And so Paul says we need to do something about this. And this is the way he puts it. As it is with me, brothers and sisters, when I came to you, I didn't come with eloquence or human wisdom as I proclaimed the testimony of God, for I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. His resolution, I resolved to know nothing among you when I come except Jesus Christ and His crucified. And the reason I think Paul relates to where we are, for he finishes up by saying, I came to you in weakness with great fear and trembling. In other words, I don't know if I can do this. If I can, it's because I have made a resolution to know nothing among you, not to brag about who I am or what I have done, except to know Jesus Christ and Him crucified. A bishop once wrote in a book I was reading recently, to a friend who was having a lot of problems making a decision. There was a pro and here was a con. We go this way or go the other way. And this is what the bishop said. If you are uncertain which of two paths to take, choose the one upon which the shadow of the cross falls. Choose the one upon which the shadow of the cross falls. I love that. That's what Paul was trying to say. I'm resolved to know nothing among you except Jesus and Him crucified. So, what about New Year's resolutions? What are we to do? Well, I've got some suggestions. This has been kind of a theological discussion, if you will, maybe. But let's be practical. And we're going to use something that's in your bulletin today. It's 101st Psalm. Now, I don't think David wrote this psalm because he wanted to write some New Year's resolutions. But when I read it in preparation for this sermon, it spoke to me over and over again. I want to point it out to you, and then we're going to read it. Is our commitment to the Lord, if that's your will and that's your wish. But David's Psalm 101, to me, is my New Year's resolution. This is what he says. I will sing of your love and justice. To you, O Lord, I will sing praise. I will be careful to lead a blameless life. When will you come to me? Lord, this year I know I'm going to be tempted to sin, and I know I'm probably going to fall, but I need you to come to me. That's my resolution. I want to try to live a blameless life. Lord knows, you talk to my wife as well, it doesn't happen too often. But I want to do that, and I want to believe and know that Christ will put me back on the track whenever I fall. That's my resolution. I will conduct the affairs of my house with a blameless heart. Wow. Now, if you're a widow or a single person or a widower or whatever, it might not be too hard to conduct the affairs of your heart, of your house, with a blameless heart. Get married, it stops right there. Life becomes more involved anytime there are two people involved, and maybe even in a single person's house. It's hard, isn't it? But that's the goal, to start there, to show those around us our love and the love of Christ, and not just be someone who in public always has a good smile, but someone who cares for those who are most precious to us. Sometimes those are the people we hurt the most. I will hate what faithless people do. I have no part in it. For the perverse of heart shall be far from me. I'll have nothing to do with what is evil. In other words, I'm going to hang out with people who are Christian. I'm going to be in a place where I'm apart from these folks. And that's one of the things, don't we say that as parents to our teenagers? If you're in a place where you're in danger, when you're too much alcohol, too much drugs, or whatever it is, if you feel that temptation, leave. Don't we say that? Leave. I think that's good advice for all of us, whether it be in a physical place or a mental place. If we're there, we feel uncomfortable about our attitude and the way we live, leave it. And he says, I want to find a way to be eyes to be faithful. Whoever slanders their neighbor will be in secret, I'll put to silence. Whoever has haughty eyes and a proud heart, I will not tolerate. Wish he hadn't put that one there about the neighbors. You know, that sounds to me about gossiping. And I find myself every once in a while kind of enjoying maybe knowing all the back and the details, don't you? Maybe it also borders on gossip. The pride of who I am and what I have is good. But sometimes it becomes something that stands in the way of my relationship to God, and maybe to one of you or two of you. So that's one of our resolutions, to deal with that. My eyes will be on the faithful in the land, that they may dwell with me. The one whose walk is blameless will minister to me. You got to find another Christian to be your partner, one way or the other. It could be a prayer group. It could be a sharing group. It could be a social network maybe. I don't know. Why not? Find a way for someone to be a partner with you in your spiritual walk. I guarantee you, you'll go better. And that's my goal, to stay with my prayer group and Bible study, to find ways to find Christian friends who support me, and I can support them. And finally, no one who practices deceit will dwell in my house. No one who speaks falsely will stand in my presence lying, not telling the truth, not being honest with who I am. It all begins first with who I am and who I am before God, and then it kind of spills over the way I treat you, doesn't it? Well, those are my New Year's resolutions. David, I don't think you wrote them for that reason, but they sure do speak to me. I'd invite you, if you would, if you're able, just to stand. Let's read those together if you feel that was something that you'd like to make your covenant with God. We'll read all those verses that's found in your bulletin there. I will sing of your love and justice. To you, Lord, I will sing praise. I will be careful to lead a blameless life. When will you come to me? I will conduct the affairs of my house with a blameless heart. I will not look with approval on anything that is vile. I hate what faithless people do. I'll have no part in it. The perverse of heart shall be far from me. I will have nothing to do with what is evil. Whoever slanders their neighbor in secret, I will put to silence. Whoever has haughty eyes and a proud heart, I will not tolerate. My eyes will be on the faithful in the land, that they may dwell with me, the ones who walk in blameless and will minister to me. No one who practices deceit will dwell in my house. No one who speaks falsely will stand in my presence. Amen. You may be seated. As we enter this time of communion, I just simply ask myself, as I ask you, what change would you like to make? What need is there in your life to change lifestyle? What aim and what goal would you want to reminding you that we can't do it alone? It's really a spiritual matter, really, even about losing weight or other type of physical commitments, isn't it? It's a matter of a spiritual issue. I invite you to make a covenant with God as you come, and you share with Him as we receive communion, that this is something I want you and I, Lord, to work with this year. I want to use the words of John Wesley to bring us to communion. He wrote these words not on New Year's Eve, but anytime we have a watch night service or a commitment service, he encourages people not to make resolutions, but to make a covenant with God. And this is the way he put it. You've heard this before, but to me it speaks so clearly of what I want to do. This is what he said. Now, beloved, let us bind ourselves with willing bonds to our covenant God and take the yoke of Christ upon us. The taking of this yoke upon us means that we're heartily content that He appoints us in our place and our work, and that He alone is our reward. Christ has many services to be done. Now, some are easy, others are difficult. Some bring honor, some bring dishonor and reproach. Some are suitable to our natural inclinations and temporal interests, but others are contrary to both. In some we may please Christ and please ourselves, in others we cannot please Christ except by denying ourselves. Yet the power to do all these things is assuredly given us in Christ who strengthens us. Therefore, let us make the covenant of God our own. Let us engage our heart to the Lord and resolve in His strength never to go back. Being thus prepared, let us now in sincere dependence on His grace and trusting in His promises, yield ourselves to Him as we pray. Let us pray. Almighty God, as we enter this time, I pray that you would remind us of where you want us to go, We want to make a covenant with you that we cannot make it through by ourselves, but we believe through your power and your strength we can. We want to echo the words of Paul as he says, when I come among you, I'm resolved to know nothing but Jesus Christ and him crucified. In his name, amen. Page 8 in your hymnal will be our communion ritual. Let me remind you again that all are invited to the Lord's table. This is his table. You're a member of this church, not a member of this church. If you're not a Christian yet, but by coming want to make your profession of faith, what a wonderful time during communion to do that. So all are welcome at the Lord's table. But before we come, we have to be in the mind to say, Lord, I come in my need and my confessions. And you'll find at the top of page 8 those very words. So I invite you to pray with me a prayer of confession and then the assurance of pardon as we pray. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. I have to confess to you, the next part is when we're going to stand in a moment and offer the word of peace to one another. I thought the other day the reason they put it right before the offering is so you can get to your purse or your billfold. But I don't know if that's true or not. I don't think so. That's the way my sinful mind thinks. Forgive me for that. But let's stand and share the love of Christ with one another. Just greet one another and be prepared for the morning offering. How are we going to do this? You going to pray? Yeah, okay. We'll ask our ushers to come forward for the morning offering.
Loving God, we thank you for a new year to serve you. As we make decisions about how that happens, give us your peace, give us a sense of your will, so that we may be wonderful followers of you, not for our own good, but for your good. We ask that you bless our gifts of time, talents, gifts, service, and witness that we give today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Just a word again to remind you that all are welcome at the Lord's table. And as you know, in the decorations of our church today, the altar is a bit crowded. So we have decided to have by intinction, or rather by standing and receiving the elements, not by intinction, but by taking the cup and the bread and taking it here. If you'd like to come and kneel at the altar, that's perfectly fine, but then make your way back. You can put your cups there in the altar railing. We feel that'll give everyone a chance to come and pray if you'd like to, but yet there wouldn't have to, the danger of getting yourself caught in some of the decorations. On page 9, we have the Great Thanksgiving. If you can join with us, appropriate reading. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image. You breathed into us the breath of life. And when we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you and blessed the bread, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here. Make and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world. Until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet, through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Again, let me remind you of our procedure. We'll have you come down the center aisles being instructed by the ushers, and you'll take the cup and the bread, and then you may kneel if you'd like to and pray, but go by the side aisles back again. And so we'll ask our usher to come at this time. Body of Christ, take and eat. measures.
Thank you.
Let us pray. What a joy, Heavenly Father, it is to be with our brothers and sisters, like heart, like mind, to enter into this holy time. May your Spirit so inhabit our hearts today that no matter what this week is like, we'll know that we have been in the presence of God and you go before us. In the name of Jesus, amen. Closing hymn, we'd like to invite you to stand and sing as we sing 117, O God, our help in ages past, 1, 5, and 6. Today and this week, we have gone through is the week of Epiphany, which reminds us that the days after Christmas are the days we celebrate the coming of the three wise men, the Magi, looking for Jesus in the temple or in the palace and found him in a stable at Bethlehem. You remember what the angel said to them as they left? Don't go home the same way. Go home a different way. That's my word to you. Go home a different way today. A different rut, if you will, and follow it as you follow your Lord. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Shall we sing together as we greet one another? God be with you till we meet again.